viewers, and a very warm welcome to this special program on Doordarshan Northeast on Quit India Movement in our talk show with me, your host, Amrita. Well, today is the 9th of August, and exactly on this day in the year 1942, the Quit India Movement, or the August Movement, was launched by Mahatma Gandhi at the Bombay session of the All India Congress Committee during the World War II, demanding an end to the British rule in our country. From 1942 to 2019, we have definitely come a very long way. And today marks the 77th anniversary of the August Movement, or the more famously known as the Quit India Movement. And to talk about this very important chapter in our freedom struggle, we have with us former professor of Debrugarh University, Dr. Sheila Bora. And we also have with us Professor Abu Nasser from Debrugarh University as well. So, ma'am and sir, first of all, thank you so much for being with us in our studio. So, today marks the 77th anniversary of the famous Quit India Movement that actually spearheaded the eradication of the British rule from our country. So, your opening thoughts on that.
Thank you, Amrita, for giving us this opportunity of being here on such an important day. Indeed, today is a very important day in the history of Indian freedom struggle, and this day is particularly important because it marked the third and last phase of our freedom struggle. It was very different to the earlier periods, to the earlier struggles, whether it was non-cooperation or civil disobedience, in the sense that it no longer remained non-violent. It also, this non-violence was also supported by some of our leaders. When Mahatma Gandhi said do and die, it was interpreted in different ways, and there were leaders like Jai Prakash Narayan who interpreted this as do and die by any means. It could, even violence could be used. As a result of which, we saw many, many young lives in our country being lost during this movement. And the numbers were huge, many were wounded, many died. Well, the fruits of this movement, I'm sure as we go on in the show, we will discuss. But definitely this left a big impact in our country.
Right. Also, sir, what are your thoughts on this? As ma'am also mentioned, the do or die, that it was no longer non-violence movement.
Yeah, actually, what happened is, we all know, more or less, we know that soon after Mahatma Gandhi's decision, announcement that we must spearhead a massive movement in order to compel the British to go out of our country and accord us independence, they were all put into jail. Most of the leaders, Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Patel, Maulana Azad, so many people were put into jail. And as a result of this, suddenly this had happened suddenly, and therefore the workers at the grassroots, they were at a loss initially. Earlier, of course, Congress party issued a kind of instruction, series of instruction, that if we have to launch a massive movement, then it is quite obvious that British government will put many of our leaders into prison. And but you all people are the leaders, by and you will have to adhere to one principle, one fundamental principle, non-violence, principle of non-violence. Do not take recourse to any kind of violent activities, and continue to spearhead the movement in a most non-violent way, so that if we become violent, British forces will get a pretext to continue their passive measure. Many of our youths will be killed, and there will be latrices. So many things will happen. Obviously, of course, even it was non-violent at the initial stage, later it became violent to a great extent. When it was non-violent, then also British government took repressive measures to put across the movement and to tally. But that was a wrong stand. It is not possible to cross a massive movement in which lakhs of people had been participating. That is not possible, humanly not possible. And that is why that created the foundation of our commitment to our country. When so many people, lakhs of people participate, sacrifice, many were injured, many were killed, that created the foundation of our country, that democratic country, and also the commitment to the country, that after so much of sacrifice, we have to now, when we became independent in 1947, they felt that yes, we must contribute to the country, build up the country as a great power. Mm-hmm. And that is why you will find that impact is like this, that when these leaders passed away in the course of time, their impact remain in the country. And when they...
It was such a massive impact they had created.
Now, of course, the young generation, I do not know whether they feel it or not, but we people who just were born just after independence, mm-hmm. we know all these things. We have read, and we our elders used to tell how they sacrificed. And that is why that created some kind of impact in our mind, that this is our country, mm-hmm. we must love the country.
The sense of patriotism was very strong.
Sense of patriotism and sacrifice mm-hmm. for the country when there is a call from the country. Mm-hmm. So that is very positive, and I think that is wonderful.
Yeah, definitely. That also, ma'am, a very interesting fact about the Quit India movement is that although it spearheaded the end of the British rule, hundreds of years of British rule in our country, initially it was a failure because there was huge suppression from the British government. There was non-cooperation from many Indian groups as well. So what do you have to, if you can throw some light on that for our viewers?
See, for this question, we have to look at the background mm-hmm. of what had been happening. Mm-hmm. You know, first thing is the Cripps mission had just failed.
Right.
And there was quite a turmoil, you know, within the country. Mm. Factionalism, different ideologies had grown. There was the Hindu Mahasabha who talked of protecting and, you know, promoting the Hindus. There was the Muslim League who had their one-point agenda about partition. There were states like Punjab, you know, who wanted special protection for the Sikhs. So naturally, you know, there was a lot of factionalism. And I find that, I mean, as we read history, you will see that there was no total support for the Quit India movement. There were groups that stayed away. Mm-hmm. Secondly, even amongst the youth, say the students who gave their sacrificed their lives in large numbers, mm-hmm. even amongst them there was divisions. There was one group which were sort of supporting the AISF, Indian Students Federation, or the left-minded, you know, mm-hmm. group. There was the other group which the nationalist-minded group, I call it, because they were the bigger group, mm-hmm. who wanted to support this movement. So there was a clash between the students. Not even all students came out. The AISF group said, well, we don't want our studies to be disturbed, no colleges should be closed, no schools should be closed, you know. So they were not for supporting the movement totally. Secondly, it all came very suddenly. Okay. You know, the leaders, the big top leaders, they were arrested in such a manner. Mm-hmm. They had no time to give clear instructions. Mm-hmm. Though Mahatma Gandhi had said, quit India, he didn't have the time to explain what he meant by quit India mm-hmm. or what he meant by do or die.
A proper agenda was not
drawn out.
They didn't have the time to prepare
that. So mm-hmm. each state interpreted it in the way they wanted. Mm-hmm. There were leaders, there were groups which said no. When Mahatma Gandhi said do and die, it meant do and die by peaceful means.
Okay.
There were other groups who said no. When Mahatma Gandhi said do and die, he let us have the liberty of using nonviolence. So the whole matter, the call for do and die was interpreted in different ways. Mm-hmm. And as a result, everything went haywire. You know, people did what they wanted, wherever they wanted, picketing, wherever. Mm-hmm. And there was so much of arson, looting. We cannot deny that there was a lot of destruction.
These things happened.
A lot of destruction happened. Railway lines were burnt, offices were burnt, people were killed. You know, there was a lot. Now, naturally, the British were not looking on. They also came down heavily on these people. And we find that the punishments that were imposed on whole villages, they came down heavily. They imposed heavy fines for small things on people. The students and the youth who participated, they were taken to far off places and left there, you know. And when they were arrested, they were beaten up mercilessly, flogged, killed to death. So all these things happened. As a result, there was anarchy, there was chaos. And in fact, historically, if you look at it, we say that the Quit India movement came to an end in 2 months' time, the do or die. Because by September, August the do or die call came, by September the AICC started appealing to everybody saying that please don't engage yourself in violent activities, now just resort to peaceful means like holding panchayats, you know, not paying your taxes, not supplying food to the army, do these type of things but do not engage. So obviously even the Congress got worried the way things were going.
But ma'am, what was the reason that, you know, it was such a big movement, but what was the reason that such a big faction, there were a lot of groups that were opposing this movement. What was the reason for their opposition?
Well, each one had their own interest. Like I said, the Hindu Mahasabha wanted that the Hindu interest should be protected. Mm-hmm. There should be no alliance with, you know, any fascist group, no okay. nothing, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. The Muslim League wanted their own partition. They were hell-bent on partition. Whereas the Sikhs wanted that whatever type of constitution came, they must have the separate, you know, electorate for that. Mm-hmm. So they had their own separate interests. And Mahatma Gandhi, the way the Cripps mission had failed because of the suggestions given by Congress. Mm-hmm. So these factions saw that they had no hopes if India achieved independence under the Congress Party. Mm-hmm. They had lost faith in the Congress Party, and that's why these people opposed the movement.
Okay. So I'll come back to you again. We had seen that there was a lot of opposition, but then there was also people who supported this movement in huge numbers, including outside support, especially from China and America.
Yeah.
So, if you can throw some light on that.
Actually, what happened is, though, you know, that several things actually contributed to the success of our freedom struggle. One is this Second World War. Mm. Second World War put the British government in a very difficult situation, because for at least 2 years they had to fight alone. Only France at Britain, Great Britain, they were fighting against the Nazi fascist forces. And later on, of course, America joined. President Roosevelt declared one war on Japan and Germany and others after the Pearl Harbor incident. Chiang Kai-shek was in favor of India's independence. All these things combined together created a very difficult situation for the British. Meanwhile, the British, Japanese forces started coming forward to Indian territory. Mm-hmm. They marched towards Burma, and then later on they came almost to our border.
Okay.
And at one point of time it was feared that they might bomb Calcutta. At that time it was known as Calcutta, today it is not Kolkata.
Mm-hmm. And it is also the capital.
Yes, that is a very big pressure.
The capital.
More significant pressure came from President Roosevelt.
Mm.
He talked to Churchill and pressurized him, actually.
Mm.
It is a fait accompli that you have to accord independence to India. There is no way out, sooner or later. Why don't you just declare that, yes, we are going to accord independence, and ask the people to cooperate in the war efforts. Mm-hmm. Churchill was not willing to do that. And at the same time, these things worked in a very, very significant way. I think the most crucial crucial development that took place in the month of February 1946. On 18 February 1946, the Indian Naval Mutiny took place. Mm. And at one point of time, Clement Attlee, when he was interviewed in Calcutta, he came to India and he was interviewed in Calcutta. He said that he admitted, yes, we had to decide that we must give independence because of the fact that the 1946 naval mutiny, mm. February naval mutiny, that shook us in a very big way. Mm-hmm. And we thought that it is now it is prudent enough to accord independence. Yeah. There is no way. And if we wait some more time, then there will be bigger mutiny, bigger than 1857 mutiny. Mm. Sepoy mutiny.
Sepoy mutiny, right.
So this international pressure, Second World War, Japanese advance towards Indian territory, then the naval mutiny of 1946, February 1946, all combined together. That ultimately enabled us to accord, to get independence just after the Second World War. And there were, of course, there are other developments. The most significant development, another most significant development is that the subaltern groups in India, among the people, they continued the movement, non-cooperation movement, and other movement as spelled out by Dr. Bora. So this actually crippled the British administration. Now, how long they will be able to continue to go on repressing the people, continue to rule the people, is almost impossible thing. And that is ultimately that made our efforts to achieve independence and successful. And we got independence on 15th of August 1947.
Right. So also, ma'am, there have been many other movements and mutinies, as sir also mentioned, before the Quit India movement. What was so special about this movement that, you know, the British, they were completely shook and they had no other way?
As I said before, because this was the first movement, it was very different to the other movements where everywhere Mahatma Gandhi, we know in 1920s when the non-cooperation movement was there, Mahatma Gandhi withdrew the movement after the Chauri Chaura incident because of violence. Mm-hmm. But here there was so much violence. This is one difference. And then in the violence, you must, you know, the patriotism of the people showed up. Young boys and girls lost their lives. If you look at Assam itself, you know, look at this young girl, Kanaklata. She was just 17 years old. And she went up to the police station trying to hoist the flag at Gohpur police station, where she was asked not to do, but she said, no, I will do my duty, you do yours. Mm. This is my duty, I will do. There were many others like this. You know, there were Mukunda Kakoti came to support her. She wouldn't let the flag touch the ground because it was so sacred. She was dying, she was falling. And then her colleague Mukunda Kakoti came from behind and held that flag. Mm. And then he was also shot. You see, and there are examples like that of other people all over, young, young boys and girls. In, I think it was in Behrampur, this young girl called Ratna, you know, she was holding a flag, and then when the police tried to shoot her, her grandmother tried to protect her, so she was also hit by the police, and then someone else came, and you know, so
numerous
in every story you will see there was a group that got injured.
it touched people's hearts, you know, it touched people's heart and soul. This way, in the other movements, you don't see people giving their lives or having been, you know, brutally assaulted like this while fighting for their freedom. But this movement was very different that way, because people spontaneously came out, and whatever each one could do in their own way, they contributed towards freedom. They knew that this is the last chance, and somehow they believed. In the previous movement, the idea was never to drive the British out of India, you see. But this was the first movement where they said British must quit. They have to quit if we are to get our freedom.
Enough of their oppression.
Enough of their oppression. So that way, this movement was very, very different to the other movements. You know, I mean, though the previous movements also were very important, it laid the base, the foundation, the way the movement went. But every time we see, we do not see this sort of violence in the movements. And, you know, there also, it was mostly youth who sacrificed a lot, their studies, their, you know, their jobs, everything. But this time it was their lives which they were laying down in great numbers and throughout the country. And here I would like to bring out, which I'm very proud of and which I always say, Konaklata Barua was the youngest martyr in the 1942 Quit India movement. Though government records mention Khudiram Bose as being the youngest, Khudiram Bose was 18 years old, and Konaklata was just 17 years, a couple of months, when she died holding the flag, you know. So it's a very proud moment
it
for
actually,
our state,
you know,
of Assam.
When we actually think about it, actually gives us goosebumps
that at such
young and tender age, they had that strong feeling of patriotism in them, and they were eager, and they didn't think twice to lay
and
down their lives.
And you'd be surprised to know she was engaged. But her marriage broke up because her in-laws and her grandfather told her that if you move around like this with the Santi Senas, and if you keep going out on processions and things, your marriage will break up. She says, my country is greater for me, let my marriage go. And her marriage broke up. You know, so you get goosebumps.
That type of sentiment
and
they
that
had.
A small 17-year girl in from a very remote village of the state. You know, you really wonder from where they got this.
Exactly. It's actually brilliant when we think about such people, and we feel actually it's a moment of pride for us as citizens of this country, and to think that we have been able to read stories of such great people and they have actually helped us breathe this free air today. So they have laid their lives for us, and we should be always thankful and feel proud
there
of
there are so
being
many of them.
Yeah, so
in,
many of
in
them.
In the country, the official records say there's 1,028 killed and 3,200 wounded in this Quit India movement.
That's the
official record, but I'm sure there must have been many
numbers
more.
Will be
this is a big I mean big number, 1,000 quite big number.
Killed.
And one thing that I used to learn from my grandfather, he was also a kind of
freedom fighter.
And he said that we used to get news from every corner in no time. At that time, there was no internet, no cell phone, there was no telephone. But news of this kind of government violence, or state atrocity spread like wildfire. And immediately these things spread, and when people come to know that Konaklata is a small girl of 17 years, she was killed, then people were not scared or not terrified. Rather,
it gave them encouragement. It inspired
the
people.
They are emboldened. They get the courage and also inspiration that we should also face British bullet in order to achieve independence. Because people came to know about it that we are going to get independence. It is a matter of several months, maybe several months or 1 or 2 years. And within that time, we are going to have self-rule, independence, and we will determine our fate. not somebody from London or some other places. So that kind of impression, idea in their mind, encouraged them to continue this movement in a very big way, despite the fact they had to face internal opposition as well as some trouble.
Right. So in spite of it all,
and also repression by the British.
The best thing is that today we live in a free country. We are the biggest democratic country in the world, and we are proud of our country, and we are proud of our all the freedoms, all the people who gave their lives for us, for eradication of the British rule, hundreds of oppression on our people. So definitely a moment of pride for us all, and we are running short of time. Thank you so much, Professor Bora and Professor Ahmed, for being with us in our studio.
Thank you.
We had a great discussion. Thank you so much for giving us an insight into this wonderful topic. Thank you so much for being with us. And viewers, we are running short of time, and today marks the 77th anniversary of the Quit India movement, the August movement, which marked an era of 100 years, of hundreds of years of British oppression in our country. So thank you so much, and hope you liked this special edition on our talk show. Thank you so much, and have a great day ahead.